Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, and welcome to the lesson one of the course on the electrocardiographic patterns in the atlas. In the lesson one, we are going to discuss the normal features of the electrocardiographic pattern in the atlas and left ventricular hypertrophy. Okay, so the first step regarding the correct interpretation of the electrocardiographic pattern in the atlas was not a time ago revised by Corrado and the other colleagues in the paper that has been published on European Heart Journal in 2010 that you can see here in the cover page. This has been the first time when the electrocardiographic characteristics in the atlas were divided into two major groups. The group one, which was called common and training-related electrocardiographic changes, and the group two, which was called as uncommon and training-unrelated electrocardiographic changes in the atlas. So, for the first time, we followed the clinical approach, which was aimed to be of help for the clinician, the practicing clinician, in order to distinguish the changes that are commonly seen in the electrocardiogram in the atlas, just from the clinical standpoint, in order to proceed with the testing when needed, or just in order to clear the atlas when any additional test was not worthy. And this clinical approach has been followed in the most recent year by a panel of international scientists which, under the guide of John Dresner, has been meeting for a couple of times, and most recently this year, 2015, to revise the criteria for interpretation of the electrocardiographic pattern in the atlas. Now, the most revised Seattle criteria or international criteria that you can see here in these slides actually have increased into three major groups. The green one, which is here listed on the left side, include a list of changes that are considered to be a normal features in the electrocardiogram in the atlas and should be considered a kind of electrocardiographic expression of the changes induced by exercise conditioning. On the right side, the red one, what are called the abnormal electrocardiographic findings in the atlas, include a number of alterations that are not strictly related to the training and so should be considered as a potential expression of the disease and require additional investigation. Then, as usual, there is a kind of a gray area, borderline electrocardiographic findings, which include a left axis deviation, atrial enlargement, right axis deviation, right atrial enlargement, or complete right bundle block, which, if present in isolation, without any other changes, should not raise relevant clinical concern. However, if they are present in association with the other changes, should be most likely considered at the same level of an abnormal electrocardiographic finds. So now we have this, let's say, simplistic but very clinically useful approach, dividing what is normal or should be considered normal in the atlas from what is not completely normal and require investigation. From the left side, in particular, among the normal electrocardiographic findings, however, there are a couple of issues that deserve a little bit more detailed attention and investigation, and which represent actually the topic of these lectures. Number one is left ventricular hypertrophy. In other terms, the increase in the voltages suggested for left ventricular hypertrophy. Okay, let's go now into this specific topic. As you know, the intensive athletic conditioning is responsible for a number of changes, including left ventricular remodeling, which include an increase in cavity size, wall thickness, and atrial and aortic dimensions. All these changes are called as atlas heart. And as a consequence, also the electrocardiographic pattern may change in the 12 lead EKG and may present some alterations that are considered an expression of the increased left ventricular dimension and mass. Among these criteria for assessing left ventricular hypertrophy from the electrocardiogram, the most commonly used is the Sokolov Lyon criteria, which is represented by the sum of the S voltages in precordial lead V1 plus the R or voltages in precordial lead V5 or 6 if they exceed 35 millimeters or 3.5 millivolts. This is considered to be positive for the presence of left ventricular hypertrophy. There are also other criteria which have been used in the clinical practice. I just want to remind the Rommel test's point score system, which is over 5 points, and the Cornell system. However, in the practice of the sports medicine, as you can see here, the Sokolov-Lyon criterion is the most commonly used. And so we, for the next slides, for the future of these lectures, we are going to utilize this criteria. And just want to show few examples of what we consider the physiologic left ventricular hypertrophy in the electrocardiogram in the athletes. For instance, this is a marathon runner, and this is the 12-lead EKG from the marathon runner, which is 30 years old, male. You can realize that there are certain typical features in this electrocardiogram. Number one, the increase in the voltages. Please have a look at these voltages in the precordial leads, and if you make the sum of the S wave here, lead precordial lead V1 plus the R wave in precordial lead V5, you can certainly exceed the 35 millimeters. Just want to catch your attention. In addition to the increased voltages, please consider that in this electrocardiogram there are certain features. Number one, the low heart rate. Here, standard is 2. Here you can see that the heart rate is quite low, is in a range of 42. Then there are mild here delay in the precordial leads V1. There is also a mild STS segment elevation in the precordial leads V4, V5, and V6. So there are a number of other issues that characterize the electrocardiogram in the atlas and are usually consistently associated with the increased voltages. Some additional examples. This is a 24-year male rower. Please have a look at the Sokolov Lyon. Here you have the S wave, and then you have the R wave. Please consider that R wave starts here and ends up right here. So the sum of the S wave in V1 plus R wave in V5 is 54 millimeters. Again, there are certain features here that deserve attention. Number one, the low heart rate again. Then, again, as I mentioned before, ST segment elevation in precordial leads, which is quite obvious here. The positive T wave, very peaked T wave in precordial leads V4 and V5. And also the very deep, very narrow, but deep cool wave in precordial leads V5, V6, but also present in the standard leads, inferior standard leads. One additional example Again, this is a cyclist, 20-year-old male. Again, here we have just the precordial leads. And again, you can see the markedly increase in precordial leads. Here again, one more example. How prevalent are these features? The prevalence of the criteria, according to Sokolov, of left ventricular hypertrophy in athletes are depending on the composition of the athletes' population. According to our experience in our mostly adult and Caucasian athletes, we have about 24-23% of left ventricular hypertrophy in athletes. The young athletes may have even greater proportion, about 45% in our population. These figures can be even larger in Afro-Caribbean athletes. According to the reports from Papadakis and Sharma, more than one-third of the Afro-Caribbean athletes, adult athletes, may have criteria for left ventricular hypertrophy, even more if you observe selected population. And adolescent African athletes may have this pattern quite commonly in about the vast majority of the study groups. What are the determinants of the increased QRS voltages in the athletes? To summarize, I would like to say that the main determinants are three. Number one, the extent of left ventricular remodeling. Number two, the type of sport, with the endurance type of sport being the most effective sports. And number three, the gender, with the male having a larger increase in voltages than females. And let's have a look. Here is one clear example of what we call left ventricular hypertrophy in athletes. This is a 20-year-old male elite canoeist. Here you can see the imaging from the echo. This is the left ventricle, ventricular septum, posterior free wall, left ventricular cavity. And here the short axis view, where you can see the ventricular septum, anterior and posterior ventricular septum, but also posterior free wall, which are increased in thickness. At the same time, also the cavity size is increased. Here the dimensions are reported, the maximum wall thickness 15 millimeters, left ventricular cavity size diastolic diameter 57 millimeters, which are values clearly exceeding the normal in considered normal in sedentary population. And here in our population, you can see that the greater extent of voltages are and S wave, particularly in precordial leads exceeding 35 millimeters, are associated with the, as average, larger left ventricular cavity, thicker left ventricular wall thickness and mass in comparison to the athletes that have less increase in voltages. These figures refer to our population of Caucasian adult athletes, but this is just a glimpse of what you can see in general population of the athletes. And with regard to the impact of type of sport, in red, you can see the histogram of people, of athletes, showing the most marked increase in voltages. And again, cycling, rowing, canoeing, middle and long distance running, they are on the top of the list. In other terms, the endurance type of sport, the sport which are associated with the most marked impact on increased left ventricular wall thickness, cavity size and mass, are at the same time also responsible for the more marked increase in left ventricular hypertrophy on the electrocardiogram. As you can see, on the other end of the scale, there are the most technical sports, such as alpine skiing, or yachting, or equestrian, which are not listed here, in which there are no substantial impact on electrocardiogram. And finally, I mentioned also the difference regarding to gender. Gender differences are quoted here. The blue one represents the men, the yellow one represents the women. As you can see, the male athletes here have the most larger proportion of voltages, particularly in precordial leads, much more than female. On the other hand, the female athletes have all usually normal or no increase in precordial lead voltages. The difference related to gender with regard to prevalence of left ventricular hypertrophy may be the consequence of several factors. Number one, the lower extent of morphologic remodeling, which is usually seen in female. If you compare male and female athletes participating in the same kind of sport, for instance, cycling, achieving the same high level of competition and participation, for instance, to the Olympics, and without any other major differences in training load, etc. However, female athletes show a lower extent of left ventricular remodeling and a lower prevalence of left ventricular hypertrophy on the electrocardiogram. And the gender difference, there is also worthy to mention the race or ethnic differences. For instance, this is an investigation that came from Magaxi a few years ago, where you can see that the voltages in black athletes, the increased voltages in black athletes compatible with the diagnosis of left ventricular hypertrophy were much more common in blacks in comparison to the white football athletes. The same finding that we are going to see in the next lectures are also present for the other electrocardiographic changes that are considered not normal, such as the wave inversion or right ventricular hypertrophy or left atrial enlargement. You can see here from these slides from Sheikh and Sharma that all these electrocardiographic changes are much more common in black athletes than in Caucasian white athletes. Okay, let's go now to the other part of the lectures, the left ventricular hypertrophy in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Because hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is the most common question when you see a left ventricular hypertrophy on the electrocardiogram. And we know from number of reports that hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is associated with a number of the electrocardiographic abnormalities, which are here listed. The most common are the diffuse T-wave inversion in precordial and standard leads, then pathologic waves, left atrial enlargement, conduction abnormalities, left axis deviation. However, I just want also to mention that it's totally possible, even in a very few cases, in a small proportion that is most likely 5% or however less than 10%, that hypertrophic cardiomyopathy may present just an isolated increase in the QRS voltages or even a totally normal pattern. Let's go to explore this issue. One of the most relevant point that should be memorized is that electrocardiographic pattern in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy usually present some alteration in the vast majority. In more than 90% of the patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, we are able to find some electrocardiographic abnormalities, either isolated or in association. And left ventricular hypertrophy is usually present in association with the other abnormalities, usually ST segment and T wave abnormalities, but also with the other abnormalities, and can be present in association in about 60% of the cases. So the issue of differentiating hypertrophic cardiomyopathy from a physiological left ventricular remodeling, just looking at the left ventricular hypertrophy in the electrocardiogram can be relevant in the clinical practice. And here again, let's have some look for the pattern of left ventricular hypertrophy in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Let's start with this example. This is a 27-year male basketball player that was competing at a very high level before diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy was made by imaging. But let's say the electrocardiogram is clearly abnormal. It's clearly abnormal not only because there is a marked increase in the voltages here. The red arrow justifies the increased voltages compatible with the diagnosis of left ventricular hypertrophy based on the Sokolov-Lyon index. However, please consider that there is ST segment depression, even mild, in the precordial leads here. There is a T-wave inversion, even deep T-wave inversion in the precordial leads from V3 to V6 and in inferior standard leads. Then there is a criteria, possible criteria for right ventricular hypertrophy here. So there are a number of changes that suggest a clearly abnormal EKG. Some other examples, a 24-year-old male with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, again a markedly increase in the voltages here, R in V6 is, in V5 is exceedingly large, totally positive. Here again a number of associated abnormalities such as the inverted T wave. Here you can see also the morphology P wave suggesting atrial enlargement. Again here. One additional example where you can recognize either increase in the voltages compatible with positive Sokolov-Lyon criteria, but here again markedly abnormal repolarization pattern, which was quite diffuse also in the inferior standard leads. One additional example, again, here is an example where the voltages are not clearly increased, but there are also other electrocardiographic changes, such as the inverted T wave. This to show that the variety of patterns are present in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and although left ventricular hypertrophy may be one of the main features, not always and not consistently is present in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Let's have a look at this small example where this is a female, young lady with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, where abnormal repolarization pattern are present, but no marked increase in the voltages. One more example, another female, where the major changes are left axis deviation, again, repolarization abnormalities here, no marked increase in the voltages of the precordial leads. So the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy presents a spectrum of electrocardiographic pattern which are consistent with the heterogeneous expression of the disease, and no one single pattern is typical and can make a diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Occasionally, in about in a small proportion, I mentioned less than 10%, normally electrocardiographic pattern or isolated increase in QRS voltages may be present. And these electrocardiographic abnormalities are not closely related with the extent of hypertrophy and with the clinical outcome. Let's have a look now specifically at this issue, the presence of normal electrocardiographic pattern or just the isolated increase in QRS voltages. This is very interesting and very, let's say, challenging topic, because an increase in quiescent voltages, isolated the increase in quiescent voltages, is what we usually consider just an expression of physiological left ventricular hypertrophy. So the idea that we can miss a diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy can be concerning. And this is the reason because we made this investigation, where a comparative analysis of the electrocardiographic patterns in athletes and in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy was assessed in order to establish to which proportion this pattern can be present. And in taking advantage of a population of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients seen in the Padua University, we were able to make a comparison, and we identified that about 2% of the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients had actually just isolated increased voltages for left ventricular hypertrophy. So making a comparison, the population of the elite athletes with the left ventricular hypertrophy, we found that normal EKG is the vast majority of elite athletes with the left ventricular hypertrophy, while are just a minority of the electrocardiographic pattern in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. When we examined the isolated increase in quiescent voltages, we found that 40% of the athletes show this pattern, so a substantial proportion of the athletes, while instead only 2% of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients. And to remark this difference in proportion, there are also certain differences with regard to the morphology. Specifically, when we see hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients with just an isolated increase in the voltages and no other electrocardiographic changes, usually these patients have a very mild left ventricular hypertrophy, and the maximum wall thickness is usually less than 20 millimeters. This is clinically relevant because, as you can see, the maximum voltage, maximum wall thickness is one of the criteria for outcome. In fact, please have a look here on the right side. Those hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients with normal EKG or just increased voltages have a very good, favorable outcome, at difference from those other ACM patients with abnormal electrocardiographic findings. Okay, in conclusion, at the end of this lecture, we can summarize in this way. Left ventricular hypertrophy is common either in athletes and in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients. And in athletes, it is responsible for electrocardiographic changes in up to 60% of the cases. Sokolov-Lyon is the most common criterion used to assess left ventricular hypertrophy in 12-lead EKG. Left ventricular hypertrophy in athletes is associated with a larger morphological left ventricular remodeling, with the male gender and the endurance type of sport. Left ventricular hypertrophy, as I mentioned, is also a common finding in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but is usually associated with the other electrocardiographic abnormalities, most commonly repolarization abnormalities, Q-wave, left atrial enlargement, left axis deviation. However, isolated Sokolov-Lyon criteria for left ventricular hypertrophy may be found in a minority, less than 5%, of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patient in association with a very mild hypertrophy and a more favorable clinical outcome. Thank you very much.